Almost half of our population, like everywhere else, constitutes women. Their selfless work at home and in hearth remains in the background. Women play many different roles. Many contribute to the family's income by doing odd jobs or through part-time employment. Women who are educated are increasingly finding employment in offices, particularly in the service sector. Women also toil in the fields and do dozens of back-breaking chores. Iconic figures like Chand Bibi, Raj Mata Ahalya Bai Holkar, Rani Lakshmi Bai of Jhansi are heroic figures held in the highest esteem by all. Others who followed in their footsteps are illustrious names like Sister Nivedita, Annie Besant, and Sarojini Naidu. Housewife responded gloriously to the call of the father of the nation and came out on the street undeterred by police barons and bullets. Later, when Netaji Subhash Bose formed the Indian National Army, the women's contingent, named after Rani Jhansi, was conceived as a powerful sword arm. Since independence, many women have made their mark in public life. They have occupied the highest offices of state and served as Prime Minister, President, and the Speaker of the Lok Sabha, as police officers and in the armed forces, as judges in the High Courts and Supreme Court. They have added great luster by their striving and accomplishment in diverse fields like performing arts, literature, cinema, they have not lagged behind in the realm of business and enterprise either. There are many women who have added luster to the glory of India through their achievements in the world of glamour. While a few individuals have reached unprecedented heights, the majority of women remains fettered by disability.
A woman will be emancipated in our country when an ordinary woman, a mother, a wife, a daughter, and a sister has got the same empowerment which we have. They should have, their opinion should be taken seriously in their own household. Then I will feel a woman is empowered. Giving her power by the Constitution is symbolic for people to realize, yes, a woman can do it.
A microscopic minority of educated women may have overcome discrimination and disabilities, but this does not mean that almost half of our population is still not treated unequally. Unfortunately, enabling legislation has been slow, its implementation has been even more tardy. Women fighting for equal rights across the nation have complained about the discrimination they continue to suffer pertaining to laws related to marriage, adoption, inheritance, employment, and others. The anguish and anger are shared by women cutting across barriers of age and bridging the ideological divide. It is this common concern that has resulted in the establishment of National Commission for Women. it would be wrong to conclude hastily that the creation of this commission was prompted by the desire to be politically correct or in tune with the Western discourse on feminism. Phool Renu Guha was the chairperson of the committee which recommended the establishment of the Commission on Women. Her role in the national freedom struggle and the women's movement in India is remarkable. The National Commission for Women was set up as a statutory body in January 1992 under the National Commission for Women Act 1990 to review the constitutional and legal safeguards for women, recommended remedial legislative measures, facilitate redressal of grievances, and advise the government on all policy matters affecting the women. It can make first-hand inspections or ask for information from the government departments dealing with subjects in its charge. It can also take cognizance of lapses, suomoto, and inquire about the progress pertaining to redress of complaints. The first commission was constituted on 31st January 1992 with Mrs. Jayati Patnaik as the chairperson. The second commission was constituted with Dr. Mohini Giri as the chairperson. Purnima Advani was at the helm from 2004 till 2007. Girja Vyas was appointed to this post in 2004, followed by Mamta Sharma, who is the present chairperson of the National Commission.
The women's movement in India struggled very hard to get a commission. Our voices was raised about 15 years prior to the commission's establishment, and we were very happy the day it was set up. It's the powers of a civil court. It has got suomoto powers of summoning people. It has got the powers to rectify any law. It has the powers also to see if the new law needs to be there. And the government of India cannot make any law without consulting the National Commission.
The cases that have come up before the National Commission for Women provide brilliant insights into the nature of Indian society and democracy at work. What is most encouraging is that an almost indivisible unity among the women has been forged under the stewardship of the National Commission for Women. This has lent a sharper edge to the demand for reservation of seats for women in the parliament and other legislatures. The role of this commission may be considered as quite vital in the empowerment of women and removing gender bias that can only cripple our democracy. Much remains to be done, and the members of the National Commission for Women are aware that the challenges are complex and the road ahead is not easy.
When I was a member of the National Commission for Women, I wrote a book after I had completed my term, which was called 12 Women in My Portrait Gallery. It was about 12 landmark cases that I did, all to do about atrocities against women. Right from honor killing to gang rape to sexual harassment. What impact the NCW can have on the country, that impact has still not been, it has still not been able to create that impact. Because people at the cutting edge, if you go to a police station in Saharanpur and you say, hum Rashtriya Mahila Ayog se aaye hain, they are totally clueless about what you're talking about.
The commission devotes a considerable part of its energies and time to raise awareness. One of the major roles of the commission is to organize workshops, constitute expert committees on economic empowerment of women, conduct workshops, seminars for gender awareness, violence against women, etc., in order to generate awareness in the society against these social evils.
If one is was proposing that there would be mediators in the police station, then again training of counselors needs to be again a very major thing in the agenda.
We should sensitize the police, number one. They don't know about 498A. They don't know about the judgment of the Supreme Court either, or the High Court's judgment, that what should they do?
The women comprise almost half the population of India. They also contribute significantly to the national economy. Ironically, their contribution is inexplicably overlooked. The commission is also charged with sponsoring various studies related to the issues of women. The work done by a woman in the household remains unaccounted for, and they remain invisible as workers. There are glaring disparities in the workload. The statistics are shocking. In one area of the Himalaya, on a 1 hectare farm, a man works for 1,212 hours in a year, a pair of bullocks for 1,064, and a woman for 3,485 hours. She spent 640 hours for weeding, 384 for irrigation, 640 hours for transferring organic manure, 557 hours for sowing, and 984 hours for harvesting and threshing. Besides working as agricultural labor on family lands, women are also employed in crafts and manufacturing in household industries and factories. Some women are also engaged in the service sector, but usually they are lowest paid.
हमारे पास जो cases आते हैं, वो बड़े different type के cases हैं. सबकी nature अलग-अलग है. Rape cases भी आते हैं, domestic violence के भी cases आते हैं, acid throwing के भी cases आते हैं, dowry के भी आते हैं, NRI भी cases आते हैं. वर्कप्लेस पे हरासमेंट के तो आप ताज्जुब करेंगे कि मुझे लगता है कि ये तो एक बहुत ही अलग अजीब सी बात है कि हमारे लिए जो लॉ बने हैं, जो एक्ट बने हैं, उनमें बिल्कुल जेंडर डिफरेंस को ख़त्म करने की बात है. और आज आज़ादी के 65 वर्ष बाद भी हम ये जेंडर को लेके बैठे हुए हैं, ये एक बड़ा दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण विषय है.
सेक्सुअल अब्यूज एट प्लेस ऑफ वर्क is an issue that few victims dare to complain about. On one hand, this isn't easy to pinpoint and prove. On the other, the worst thing is that the person who's preyed upon, in most cases, is dependent on the predator for her livelihood. The threat that silences her is this vulnerability. Complaining about sexual abuse can lose her job and make her even more vulnerable. Stigma of sexual abuse is difficult to wash off. The Supreme Court of India, in the landmark Vishakha judgment, has ordered each office to put in place a grievance redress mechanism. The National Commission for Women has taken great pains to raise awareness about this problem by conducting workshops, establishing helplines, and providing counseling. Legislation since independence has sought to abolish child marriages, but the customary malpractice continues to survive in rural areas. Girls are the worst sufferers. They are given away in marriage before they are physically or emotionally mature. Their education is stopped at the primary school stage, and they are traumatized for life. Childbearing at an early age ruins their health. The young innocent brides can also be exposed to molestation at their new homes. The commission accords highest priority to combating this social ill. It has endeavored tirelessly to expose this malpractice and to ensure that those who breach the law are swiftly punished. At the same time, educational campaigns have contributed significantly towards building up public opinion against child marriages and in favor of educating the girl child. To reinforce this message, the Commission puts great emphasis in disseminating information about various schemes launched by the government to improve the life chances of girls.
सशक्तिकरण की बात तो बहुत करते हैं सशक्तिकरण महिला एम्पावरमेंट लेकिन हमने ये नहीं सोचा कि हम कभी ग्रोथ की बात नहीं करते हम डेवलपमेंट की बात नहीं करते वो इन सबसे मिलीजुली एक वो है कि जब ये सबका एक कॉम्बिनेशन बनेगा साथ में शिक्षा शिक्षा के नाम पे जब लिटरेसी की बात आती है तो लिटरेसी में आप ये देखिए कि वो कर देते हैं कि नाम पढ़ना सीख गई नाम लिखना सीख गई ये लिटरेसी नहीं जब तक कि वो कुछ पढ़ ना ले कुछ समझ ना ले कुछ लिख ना ले वो लिटरेसी हुई एजुकेशन तो फिर ऑलराउंड डेवलपमेंट हो गया बच्चे का
These special schemes cover a wide gamut. Some focus on providing educational facilities, scholarships, etc. Education is the best way to empower the girls and women. The Commission accords highest priority to facilitating access to education for the girl child and young adolescents. Implementation of various governmental schemes are monitored by the Commission. It feels that if the girls receive proper education in the early years, they are much better equipped to assert their rights, articulate their aspirations, and reclaim an equal status as a citizen in a democratic state. Other programs promote self-reliance through skill development and encourage thrift, cooperation, and self-help. Some governmental schemes seek to promote microfinance at the grassroots levels to enable small-scale women entrepreneurs to become self-employed, self-reliant, and economically independent.
I think that the time has come now when all the laws for all the women should be similar. In order to do that, in my time, we also proposed an amendment and said that there should be compulsory registration of marriages. And by that very fact, you do away with by saying that I have had a Muslim marriage, I have had a Hindu marriage, I have had a Sikh marriage. Every Indian will have to get married and get it registered.
There are problems beyond registration of marriages for women. Honor killings sanctioned by notorious Khap panchayats are shameful examples of inhuman atrocities perpetrated by obscurantist elements in rural society who wish to deny women the right to marry whom they wish within or without the caste or community of their birth. The National Commission for Women has intervened in many of such cases and ensured that the guilty are brought to justice and provided the healing touch to the victims. Dowry has been the bane of traditional marriages in India. The groom's family in many cases believes that it has a right to extract as much it can from the bride's family in the form of expensive gifts and cash. The brides who fail to comply are harassed and humiliated, at times unable to bear the agony, the poor women even commit suicide. The rising number of dowry deaths and cases of bride burning has been a cause of alarm. The National Commission for Women has tried hard to curb such incidents, It has acted as a powerful advocacy group for the establishment of special cells in the police stations to investigate crime against women. Cases of domestic violence are not restricted to those related to dowry. Merely reporting such incidents to police is of little help. The Commission is aware that the victim in such cases need urgent medical help as well as psychological counseling to heal their wounds. The Commission has devised innovative measures,
Parivarik Mahila Lok Adalats, in order to redress the grievances of thousands and thousands of cases which are pending in the courts. There were nearly 10 lakh cases pending. So since we had this civil power, we would gather all the cases, we would put them all in a line, we will make a huge court on a Saturday and Sunday, anywhere, wherever we could find place, in a school building or anywhere. The judges would be invited to come, and these cases, at least a lakh of cases were disposed of during that my tenure.
These quasi-judicial bodies not only provide inexpensive and speedy justice, but also make possible reconciliation between the couple. Regarding the family courts, the Commission has recommended that there shall be one or more family courts in every district, and the appeal under these matters will lie only to the high courts. Rape and molestation are most heinous crimes committed against women. Unfortunately, legislation providing for deterrent punishment for rapists have failed to provide protection to the vulnerable. Children and those belonging to the weaker sections of society are the worst sufferers. Acquittal of the accused due to legal technicalities or reluctance of the investigating agencies to pursue cases involving powerful persons have time and again outraged the public. The Commission has played an important role in spearheading the fight against such miscarriage of justice. Age-old prejudices are hard to get rid of in tradition-bound rural society. Indians continue to pray for a boy when expecting a child. This inevitably results in oppressive gender bias discriminating against the girl child. Sex determination tests during pregnancy are illegal but flourish despite the ban. Girl fetuses are ruthlessly aborted by many parents, and female infanticide remains a dark blot. The National Commission's interventions have inspired young civil servants to become proactive in eliminating this social ill.
See, there is no point in going and telling the mother, don't kill the child, because there is just acceptance for the practice. The men, the community, all of them are forcing the mother, and there was patriarchy was very alive. So the mother alone could not prevent the child from being killed. So we had to change the mindset, we had to mobilize the community.
The district collected in Dharampuri in Tamil Nadu made effective use of folk art forms to sensitize the villagers and organize the community to dramatically almost remove female infanticide. It was important to involve the local villagers in this campaign. The pride of women all around was restored, and today the problem of female infanticide is a distant memory. The Commission has inspired many such initiatives all around the country. Child mortality statistics show that the girl child has the dice loaded against her. Denied proper postnatal care, young girls are far more malnourished than boys in the family, and when they fall ill, they are often denied timely treatment. It is largely due to the initiatives of the National Commission for Women that the pre- and postnatal care for the mother, especially the girl child, has improved dramatically. Even small towns in different parts of the country have specialized care for the mother and the child. The efforts of the commission have ensured that the girl child gets best treatment and medical facilities since the day she arrives in the world. Women, and especially the young ones, are exposed to many vulnerabilities. In some parts of the country, girls are sold. The reasons for this can be many, but the problem cannot be denied. It is only due to the intervention of the commission that such incidents have reduced. The parents and the families are sensitized about the issue. National Commission has worked as an effective watchdog to safeguard the interest of women prisoners and those taken in custody by police. Those responsible for law enforcement are sensitized not to violate the privacy or infringe on the dignity of a woman, however weak or helpless she may be. The Commission takes a keen interest in arranging vocational training for women prisoners and their rehabilitation.
Indian democracy mein mahila ka bahut bada yogdan hoga apni sanskriti ko barqarar rakhne mein, desh ko aage lane mein, desh ki प्रगति में देश के डेवलपमेंट में बहुत बड़ा महिला का योगदान होगा इसलिए मैं समझती हूँ कि मैं तो यही कहूँगी कि पुरुष और महिला कंधे से कंधा मिला के चलें तो देश और प्रगति की ओर जाएगा।
There are some who complain about the limitations the National Commission for Women works under. It is difficult to overlook that it has, in a short span of time, succeeded in restoring the self-respect to half of the nation's population, given them new hope, and encouraged them to play their role in the democratic life of India that is envisaged in the Constitution.